Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to continue exploring some numerical differentiation techniques. In particular, we'll talk about the theory behind the centered difference method. We'll begin by exploring the fundamentals of numerical differentiation, we'll do a quick review of Taylor series approximation, and then derive our centered difference method theory. Let's quickly recap what numerical differentiation is. In numerical methods, differentiation involves approximating the derivative of a function at some point using numerical techniques rather than exact mathematical formulas. Through approximations, we simplify a ton, and we can get very close to our actual answer with significantly less work. Let's begin by remembering the definition of a derivative. If we begin with a secant line, that is, a line passing through two points on our function, the difference in y over our difference in x is just going to be our slope between these two points. Then, as we learned in calculus, as our delta x term gets smaller and smaller, our function begins to approximate the tangent line at input x, which is the derivative as the limit goes to zero. This line becomes the instantaneous rate of change at point x. Well, how does that help us understand numerical differentiation? If we are okay with good approximations of what this derivative is, and not exactly as we could in, say, an analytical sense, we can say that the derivative at point x is roughly the change in our function across a very small change in x. Thereby, assuming a finite, small change in x, we can make our lives much easier and solve much more complicated problems by giving up some accuracy. So, how does this work and how does it relate to the centered difference method? Well, we want an understanding of how much accuracy we need to give up in order to get a good approximation of our derivative. Well, how do we go about finding that? The way we do it is through Taylor series. If you recall or have not learned in the past, Taylor series represents a function as an infinite sum of terms. And what it does is it provides an approximation of a given function within a certain interval around a center point that we give it of the series. The series itself does not necessarily give the entire function, but rather it gives an extremely good local approximation of the function around the center point using the derivatives at that point. Therefore, the Taylor series approximation does not always give us a function with a domain from negative infinity to positive infinity. To illustrate this, let's look at the Taylor series for the function e to the x centered at 1. Looking at our formula here, our x is a small future x value that we are going to be finding. A is our center point, and n is our term's power, which will make more sense here shortly. Now, let's say that we want to find up to our second order Taylor series approximation. Firstly, we begin at n equals 0. Then, we will go back through and simplify after. Then we will move to our higher power terms. Then, from here, you could continue to add terms, hence the definition of Taylor series as an infinite sum. But we will cut it off here, and we could say that our next term would be of order to the third power. But we'll talk about that shortly. Simplifying our Taylor series, we get the following equation. Let's plot our actual e to the x function, and then the first and second order Taylor series approximations at a center point of 1. The first order expansion will just be the first two terms here, and this is simply a straight line. Secondly, our second order expansion is an even better approximation, as it uses a parabola. If you were to continue, a third order would give you a cubic. As you can see, within a small range around our center point, we have a very good approximation of our function. However, when we deviate too far from our center point, our approximation becomes worse and worse. This is because we are truncating or cutting off additional fitting terms in our Taylor series expansion. With each additional term, our approximation gets better and better as we have less error. Now that we have reviewed Taylor series approximation, how does this help us understand the error of our centered difference method? Well, as we learned in the last few videos with the forward difference method and the backwards difference method, the error that we receive is proportional to our step size. We also learned that for both of these methods, the error can be reduced by simply decreasing our step size. But what if we cannot reduce our step size, but we still want to reduce our error? Well, this is where the centered difference method comes in. Let's imagine a situation where we have some points that look like this. Well, we cannot simply reduce our step size, as we do not know what our underlying function looks like. And although we could use interpolation, plot the function, and then reduce our step size, this practically eliminates our purpose for numerical differentiation and the simplicity of it. So, in the forward and backwards difference method, we have used a point either before or after our point of interest. But what if we used more than one data point to predict the derivative of x? Specifically, we'll use a point some fixed distance ahead and some fixed distance behind our point of interest. And we will call this h, or you might also see it called delta x. Let's begin by writing out our forward and backwards Taylor series approximations. One thing to note here in the backwards group is that we have negative terms in the odd-powered terms, which we learned about in the backwards difference method theory video. We can then rearrange both of these terms for f of xi. Now, let's combine these two equations by subtracting equation 1 from equation 2. As you can see, all of our initially even terms within equation 2 are going to become negative with this subtraction, and cancel the terms in equation 1. Then we can solve for the first derivative of xi, which is what we have been looking for. Then let's divide by minus 2h to isolate for the derivative, and we end up with the following terms. Much like we did with the forward and backwards difference method, this first term is going to be our centered difference method, and the remainder will be our truncation error. But the important thing to note here is that the error is now proportional to h squared. Therefore, we have now just decreased our error without changing our step size as we had set out to do. Briefly, you may ask, if the error developed by the center difference method is going to be better than those in the forward and backwards difference method, why would we use either of those methods? Well, in certain scenarios, the center difference method is less appropriate, such as situations if our function is not smooth, it is more computationally heavy than both the forward and backwards difference method individually. If we do not have data in front or behind our center point, we cannot use the center difference method. And these are just a few of the reasons why we might use the forward or backwards difference method instead of the center difference method. All that to say is that we just need to decide on our numerical differentiation method based on the information at hand. In the next video, we'll walk through a full example implementing this method, so be sure to check out that video to round out your knowledge of the centered difference method. I hope that this video helped your understanding of the theory behind the centered difference method. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our YouTube memberships by clicking that join button down below. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below and I will do my best to address your concerns.